Please rise. Please rise if you're able. You may be seated. Dying, Christ destroyed our death. Rising, Christ restored our life. Christ will come again in glory, as in baptism. Joel put on Christ, so that in Christ Joel may be clothed with glory. Hear it now, dear friends. We are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have hope purify themselves, as Christ is pure. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet they shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you will live also. Now we welcome to place the pall. For all of you who are baptized into Christ have been clothed yourself with Christ. In his baptism, Joel put on Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, he shall be clothed with glory. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith and celebrate the life of Joel. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace, that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow hope, and in death resurrection. We ask you to please rise and join me in singing number 77, How Great Thou Art. You may be seated. I'll ask you to please join me in the prayers you see printed in your bulletin. Eternal God, we praise you for the great company of all those who finish their course in faith and now rest from their labor. We praise you for those dear to us whom we name in our hearts before you. Especially we praise you for Joel, whom you have graciously received into your presence. To all of these, grant your peace. Let perpetual light shine upon them, and help us so to believe where we have not seen, that your presence may lead us through our years and bring us at last with them into the joy of your home, not made with human hands, but eternal in heavens, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, our first reading comes to us from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, 1 through 4. For everything there is a season, a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. Our second Old Testament reading comes to us from the book of Isaiah, chapter 41, verse 10. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will hold you with my victorious right hand. Our next reading comes to us from the book of Psalms. It's chapter number 23, and it's one that you may know, and I would encourage you to please join in if you'd like. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And our gospel readings come to us first from the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And our next reading comes to us from the book of John, chapter 3, 16, and then John 14, 1 through 3. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go and prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you will be also. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So we hear in the book of Ecclesiastes that in God's ordered and wonderful world, there is a season for all things. There is a season of life, but there is also a season for death. Joel was an avid gardener, and so he would have understood this seasonal way of life. As the plants grow in the spring and they spring up and you see the beauty of the flowers, but even those flowers then fade and eventually fall into the ground and die. But you see, the wonderful part about it, and the reason why Jesus so often used these images for our lives and what the kingdom of heaven is about, is because locked in that cycle, locked up in that cycle of life that God has ordered, is always rebirth. Is always life again, because God is a God of life and light. God is a God when we see death, he sees life. And Joel would have understood this, like I said, as he planted the seeds and watched them grow. In the same way, our life is like a season. We too grow and flower. But as Isaiah says, the flowers wilt, but only the word of God is forever. And so we too live this life. We live this life and flower and eventually go, as all must, to death. We all fall into the ground and die. But the truth is, what's locked up, and we're going to hear this in the song that's coming up, is that even in death, there is the promise of life. We see it all around us as we go through the season, through winter, that eventually leads to spring and new life, and the cycle continues. And in this amazing, beautiful, wonderful world that God has created for us, as we live in this cycle, we also leave behind a wonderful legacy. And I got to meet Joel's family, and what a wonderful legacy he left. Just as the seeds fall into the ground, as Jesus said, when a seed falls on the ground, it dies, but it bears much fruit because more will grow from it. Joel's legacy is here amongst all of you whose lives that he touched, lives that he affected, lives that he made better through his faith and through his life. That is the next harvest that is growing, the harvest of God's wonderful world, the harvest of God who tends all of us. So as we hear that song, I want you to listen a little bit. I want you to listen to that promise that is locked up even in death. That promise that tells us that when this life ends, that God has something for us. God has life everlasting. Because Jesus Christ, as we heard in the John reading, came in this world so that we may find life eternal. That God loved us so very much that he sent his son to die on the cross so that when our cycle of life, our season of life ends, that indeed we will find life and life everlasting. That God loved Joel so much that God sent Jesus into the world to die for him as he did for each and every one of us. And in that death, there is the promise of new life and rebirth. In that place that maybe we don't completely understand, that place that we get glimpses of in the book of Revelations where he says that all tears will be wiped away and death will be no more. We get glimpses of it in Jesus, it says, that will be a place with rooms for all, a place where Jesus has made a specific place for each and every one of us, all who have heard his words, all who have followed him in our lives. Yes, Joel understood that seasons of life and death. He understood this great and wonderful world. As a fisherman, he explored the world. As a postman, he would have known this wonderful seasonal world that we live in God's ordered and wonderful world. Jesus promises, Jesus whose words are trustworthy and true, that when this life ends, when we are like the flower that fades and wilts and falls to the ground, that he will be there. That he will be there to take us to that final place. That we do not pass through that difficult and mysterious thing of faith alone, but instead God, Jesus, goes with us. That when our hand falls to this earth, he catches it. Jesus Christ, who loved us so much to die on the cross, will take us to that final place. That final place that I imagine is a place where their flowers always bloom, where the winter never comes, where it's joy everlasting. The place that, like I said, we just get glimpses of, but we know is there because Jesus Christ has come into the world to open that way for us, is the way, the truth, and the life. It is a promise that is made to each and every one of us in our lives. It is a promise that I hope you hear very well this morning. For each of us will go through these seasons of our lives. Each of us will go through the seasons of flowering, but also all of us will go to death. And it is a promise that is made to each and every one of us that if we live that life, as we clothe ourselves with Jesus, we are clothing ourselves with the life eternal, the life everlasting, the life abundant. It is a promise that we must hear, and it is a promise that Joel heard in his life as he lived out his faith in this world. It is a promise that I believe was a promise that we hear, but is a promise that was true and a promise that was fulfilled with Joel as his life here ended and his life in the hereafter began. So although Joel is gone from us now, God sees life, and God sees life eternally. So although his life ends here now, it is not over, but just another beginning of another spring of flowers and joy. Amen. Now I ask that you rise and please join me in number 707, Hymn of Promise. Please be seated. Let us pray. God of love, we thank you for all which you have blessed us even to this day, for the gift of joy in the days of health and strength, and for the gift of your abiding presence and promise in the days of pain and grief. We praise you for our home and friends and for our baptism and place in your church. And all those who have faithfully lived and died, above all else, we thank you for Jesus, who knew our grief, who died our death and rose for our sake, and who lives and prays for us now. And he taught us to pray, so now we pray. Please join me in the way that Jesus Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May I ask you to please rise for the benediction. Now, as we finish up today, you'll be invited to go to the gravesite if you'd like, or if you don't, you can go downstairs for a time of fellowship, and then we'll be having lunch following the gravesite. Now may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do his will, working amongst us that we may, which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.